Also, I know we have a number of permanent representatives and ambassadors here. We do have a few seats in the front reserved for you, so I invite you to take those seats in the front of the room. Thank you.
Forests are part of our life. They protect us as we grow. They clean the air we breathe. They give us food, water, and health. They provide shelter, employment, and income. Look around. Can you imagine your life without them? On the 21st of March, think about our forests. Sustain them. They are our future.
Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to the second celebration of the International Day of Forests here at FAO headquarters in Rome. I'd like to welcome our Director General, José Graziano da Silva, ambassadors and permanent representatives, Mr. Guillaume Lacerda, Director of the Brazilian Development Bank, dear colleagues, ladies and gentlemen. Last year, we looked at forests in the landscape context, and we were amazed at the broad number of activities and outpouring of support for our forests. And this is support that we saw through the many images uploaded by the public on the FAO Forestry website. We wanted to congratulate those who took action last year for their enthusiasm and successes, as well as those who are continuing their activities this year. Whether we're young or old, and you know who you are, it's clear that people are taking action to improve the world's forests because they cannot imagine their life without them. Yet we know it's not easy to look after our forests, particularly if we don't have access to the technology or training that can help us improve them. So this year, FAO decided to take stock of what has been done to help people manage and monitor their forests. And during this event, we're going to look at new ways of using technology to assist forest monitoring and management. And you're going to hear from a few experts that have collected up-to-date information on changes to forest area using remote sensing technology and how people in a variety of countries are successfully managing and monitoring the world's forests. And leadership is a key part of these efforts. And there are leaders here with us today who can help us guide us through this process. We are honored to have the FAO Director General, José Graziano da Silva, to provide us with his leadership and perspective on the importance of forests in our lives. And I would now invite the Director General to make a few opening remarks. Mr. Director General, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Permanent representatives to FAO, distinguished guests, Maria Elena, Eduardo, it's a pleasure to welcome you all to FAO to celebrate the International Day of Forests. In 2014, we are doing this in the context of the International Year of Family Farming. Forest people are part of this group of family farmers also, among pastoralists and artisan fishers. They represented hundreds of millions of families that play a key role in guaranteeing food security in many countries. In many cases, they are also directly responsible for the sustainable management of forests and natural resources. But at the same time, they are among the world's most food insecure people. This means this meeting is an opportunity to expand the dialogue on what we need to do to support them and strengthen sustainable forest management. We need this because forests play a central role in maintaining global climate equilibrium, protecting soils, regulating the water cycle, preserving biodiversity, and providing livelihoods and food for over 1 billion people in the world. Forests cover one-third of the global's land area and are home of over 80% of the total biodiversity. Three-quarters of the fresh water used for household, agriculture, and industrial needs provide through forest watersheds. Over two-thirds of the global population relies on medicines derived from forests as their primary form of healthcare. These are just a few examples of the importance of forests in our lives. It is our responsibility to use them sustainably. And we need to do this because there are over 1 billion forest people worldwide whose livelihoods depend on forests. They need to have the tools and support to use the managed forest in a sustainable way. When this does not happen, they are forced to engage in activities that promote undesirable outcomes such as the degradation or even destruction of forests. It's up to us to offer viable alternatives, improve the governance from the local to the global level, must underpin our attempts at sustainable forest management. And we can see the benefits when we support them. The adoption of sound policies are helping to reduce land degradation and deforestation and improve the health of forestry in countries like Ecuador, Vietnam, Zambia, and many others. Forest restoration and tree planting have significantly helped to reduce the net loss of forest area, especially in Asia. By acting this way, we can use forests now and at the same time preserve them for future generations. That is central to sustainable development. This is an approach that is central to the revised strategic framework of FAO. Forest-related issues have gained visibility and momentum in the international dialogues. It is encouraging that sustainable forest management and the livelihoods of forest people are among the issues of the post-15 development agenda. Ladies and gentlemen, experience has taught us that the foundation of solid policy decision-making and inclusive and conclusive public debates is sound information. This is why FAO is using this year of the International Day of Forests to ask how we can improve the availability of information on the state of forests at all levels, national, regional, and globally. FAO has a long tradition and expertise in forest inventories and national forest monitoring and assessment system. This is a data gathering process that has been strongly propelled by REDD+ and the need to monitor forest-related carbon stocks. As you know, forests retain as much carbon as the entire atmosphere. So the way we lose, manage, or restore them has serious implications for the decline, for the climate, for the millions of people who rely on forests for their livelihoods, and ultimately for every citizen in this planet. We also need reliable data to understand where and how deforestation is happening so that we can take the necessary step to stop it. Many countries are taking measures to improve their forest monitoring system, FAO is honored to be part of these efforts. FAO, the governments of Brazil and the countries of Congo Basin are finalizing an innovative project to assist 10 member countries in Central Africa, Forest Commission, the COMIFAC, to improve the monitoring of their forest cover. That's the second tropical basin, most important. In fact, that's what brings to Rome one of our guests, Mr. Guilherme Lacerda, from the Brazilian Development Bank. I didn't saw him. Yeah? Oh, he's on the way. Ladies and gentlemen, in closing, let me invite you to the two events on the forest calendar this year. First one, the FAO Committee on Forestry meeting that starts on June 23 here in headquarters. And the fourth World Forest Congress that begins on September 7 in Durban, South Africa. I hope you enjoy today's presentation and discussion on the new ways of monitoring and managing forests. Thank you for the attention.
Thank you, Mr. Director General. We appreciate. Thank you for being here again and for giving us a near and longer term perspective on how forests are key to sustainable development. So we're now going to hear from the latest trends on forest area. And I would like to give the floor to Mr. Ken MacDicken, who's the Senior Forestry Officer in FAO's Forest Assessment, Management, and Conservation Division. He's going to provide us with some updated information on our forest area based on the results of FAO's Global Remote Sensing Survey. Mr. MacDicken, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Lauren. And now maybe you'll be able to hear me. It's a privilege, indeed. But before I start, I'd like to make an important introduction of the people who actually did this work. I'd like to introduce Mr. Remy Denuncio. Please stand, Remy. Mr. Eric Lindquist, both from FAO. Remain standing, please. And Frederick Gachard from the European Commission Joint Research Center at ISPRA. I'd like to lead us all in a round of applause for them because they did great work on this and you're about to hear about their work, not mine. Well done. You can see that I was selected to make this presentation because I'm the largest of the group. In 1923, we first learned as a society about the world's forest. Until then, we knew almost nothing as a society about global forest resources. In 1948, in the aftermath of World War II, FAO began monitoring forest resources primarily for one purpose, to understand what wood would be available in the global reconstruction effort. Since then, FAO has continued to monitor forest resources and change. So all of this effort through these years was a lot of effort by countries, by FAO, by partners. But the question might be, what difference did it make? I think there are four key global results that have made a substantial difference since 1923. The first is something that now we take for granted, that there has been tremendous forest loss in the tropics. This monitoring effort detected that, and as a result, resulted in 60 plus years of investment. Tens of billions of dollars invested in the improvement of tropical forestry. Another important point is that gaps in wood supply were identified through this process, both locally, nationally, regionally, and globally. And the projections of those gaps resulted in massive efforts to increase planting of new forests, which already in many cases are providing much of the wood that we use today. Thirdly, we didn't at the time that this forest monitoring began know very much about global climate change. But one result of this process is that we now understand that forest conversion is an important source and an important contributor to global climate change. What this resulted in was forest management is now part of the solution, as well as being part of the contribution to global greenhouse gas emissions. Finally, since the 1920s, beginning with aerial photography, we know that remote sensing is a proven tool for forest monitoring. As a result of that knowledge over these years, there are now some 100 Earth-observing satellites, many of which provide useful information about forest resources and change. Since 1948, much of the information that we have learned about global forests has come from one single source. That's the Global Forest Resources Assessment that FAO has conducted since 1948. But we also know that there is no single source of reporting data that is completely adequate, regardless of the source. So we know also that the combination of FRA country reports, which are submitted by countries to FAO, and systematic efforts to do and analyze remote sensing adds value to our understanding of forests and how they are changing. Starting in 2009, the European Commission Joint Research Center and FAO began to analyze Landsat data to assess forest land use change, beginning with imagery for the year 1990. That survey includes over 13,000 sample sites, which were reviewed for their land use characteristics by experts from over 100 countries, including over 200 people, national experts who participated. Many of the results from the initial publication and the methods for this effort are published in FAO Forestry Paper 169, which is available on the web. To 2010, which is the most recent assessment. This is a lengthy process, which is very detailed, but it takes some time. The world had 3.88 billion hectares of forest in total. Tropical forests remain the largest single forest type by climatic domain, about 45% of the world's total. Boreal forest was next, followed by temperate and subtropical forests. So if you keep in mind those proportions, it helps to understand the importance of change in each of those domains. People are often interested in the gross changes and the net changes. The annual global forest change numbers are here. About 15 million hectares per year of gross loss, about 10 million hectares of gross gain, leaving a net of about 5.3 million hectares of net loss per year. Or for this period of 1990 to 2010, about 110 million hectares of total net loss. But the global story is not the whole story. In fact, probably the most important story is at the climatic domain level. How has forest changed over time, and where has it changed over time? You can see from this simple graph that tropical forest is where forest is being lost. In the boreal zone, the temperate zone, very static. Slight increases in the subtropics as a result of planting and natural regeneration. But the greatest forest loss is in the tropics. I'd like to speak briefly about the regions of significant change within the tropics, since it's where most of that forest dynamic is taking place. Tropical South America, because it's the largest tropical forest zone, also has the largest tropical forest loss. As a proportion of total loss, tropical South America accounts for about half of the total of forest loss during this period. You can see that it's a pretty steady loss, and the rate of change during this period has not changed much. These graphs are all to scale, so you can see that tropical Africa has a smaller total tropical forest area. It accounts for about 25% of the total tropical forest loss. Fortunately, these numbers came out to be quite nice chunks, 50, 25% each. Asia is a little more complicated because it has subtropical, temperate, and tropical areas in substantial quantity. In the tropics, again, forest loss, about 25% of the total global tropical forest loss. But subtropical and temperate areas in Asia are increasing in area, had increased in area through this period, in both cases. Well, remote sensing provides us with some clues, and I hope that many of you will come back to us later and talk with us about more details. But remote sensing provides us with some clues about what's going on in the world's forest. But remember, this is all from outer space. This has to be complemented by ground-based data, which will be discussed later today. But this includes natural versus planted forests, information about forest stocks. What's actually in this forest? We know something about how many hectares there are and where they're located, but we also need to know what's in them. We also are working to understand protection and conservation of forest, how much area is conserved, what the impacts are on biodiversity, et cetera. Management and production, very important. All of us are users of forest products, and it's most important that we understand where it's coming from, what its future is. Last but not least, the economic and social values that are associated with forests and people who depend on forests. None of this comes from space. It all comes from ground-based work. Fairly obvious, but it is the other part of that complementary data set that we talked about at the beginning. Part of it from outer space, part of it from the ground. What it leads us to is an understanding over time of an important dynamic. That is, really, how much forest is there per person over time? Since 1923, for these selected countries for which we have some data, you can see these trends. The y-axis, the vertical axis, is a logarithmic scale. So you can see the dramatic changes over time in the amount of forest that exists per person. This is a wake-up call still. It's a wake-up call that says we have, in many ways, a less than 20% of the amount of forest per person now that we had 90 years ago. That forest is the forest that we depend upon to provide goods and services. You can see the differences between these regions. Asia obviously started with more people and less forest per person, but has declined at the same kinds of rates as the other regions. In summary, I think it's safe to say that forest monitoring provides tangible results and provides tangible returns on investment. If these investments had not been made by our predecessors, we wouldn't understand that the tropical forests are being lost. We wouldn't understand that forests contribute to climate change. Those investments were vitally important then for us, and present-day investments are vitally important for the future. We also know that global forest area continues to decline at a steady rate, but there is some hope that there are gains in some regions and some forest types. Not an impossible situation. We also know that forest conversion is an important part of land use change and the loss of forest, particularly in the tropics. And that's primarily due to the demand for agriculture. As populations increase, demands for more food increase, demands for land increase, demands for forest land to be converted increase. We need to continue monitoring forests. We need to continue thinking about them and, more importantly, acting about them if we are to provide forest goods and services not only for our generation, but for generations to come. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ken, for providing us with some of those updated trends and for showing us some of the impacts caused by those trade-offs between maintaining our forests and land conversion. Very important, and it's amazing how much technology has helped us better understand our forests, even since the 1920s. Very interesting. We're glad to have your team tackling this important issue and working hard on that data, so thank you very much again. Now, Ken, you mentioned this issue of getting data from outer space, but we know that we need more than just the area of forests and changes, that data from outer space. Over time, we need that real impact on the ground. We need to collect some more information on the ground. And so this is why we continue to go to countries with questionnaires to obtain more details on their forests, and we're getting men and women involved in this process. So I'd now like to introduce Mr. Eduardo Mansur, Director of the Forest Assessment, Management, and Conservation Division, who's going to tell us more about this process and give us some interesting examples of how it works. Mr. Mansur.
Sorry,
Yes.
Ken. Distinguished guest, Mr. Director General, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you so much for the opportunity to bring to you some highlights of the FAO work on forest monitoring during this important celebration of the International Day of Forests. As we saw in the important and interesting information provided by my colleague, remote sensing provide wonderful data and tool for us to know more about our forests. Forest monitoring goes beyond and include the field data. So I'm going to talk to you about the overall work that FAO and partners are conducting on forest monitoring, including the field work. Let's start with a bit of context. FAO's first global forest assessment was undertaken at the request of the very first FAO conference in 1945. And that effort led to establish what we have now as the Forest Department. Not surprisingly, one of the key findings was that we did not have sufficient information on the world's forests. So FAO has been supporting countries to develop national forest inventory and establish forest monitoring systems ever since. And we continue to do so thanks to the generous support of some resource partners, thanks to the interest of the countries, and thanks to the experts that so wholeheartedly contribute to this process. Our goal is to give countries continuing capacity to monitor and assess their own forest resource. Knowing that we are going to be making this talk today, we contact some of our colleagues in the field so we could give you real-time information on the dynamic work going on in some of the forests of the world in terms of monitoring, of course, on this very day, 21st of March. As we celebrate the International Day of Forests, we are currently supporting monitoring in projects in about 48 countries. There should be a video. Because colleagues were so cool to produce the video, how can we put the video on?
Sorry.
There it is. Yes, I mentioned to you that we are supporting projects in 48 countries, and today, in those countries, we estimate that about 1,000 people are out in their forests measuring and collecting information about trees and the forests and the land use, writing down the results by hand or using quite sophisticated handheld devices. With new technology, countries now download images sometimes twice a day from satellites, helping them, for instance, to determine if there are threats of fire. Through these ongoing monitoring efforts, 25 countries have found big changes from what they saw 10 years ago. 15 countries have set up their own national forest monitoring systems with FAO support. And 10 more countries have now, that will complete their national forest inventories in the next 2 years. In 5 of them, they are already beginning the second round of measurements, which, as you can imagine, improve a lot the reliability of the data they generate and they are able to provide. These are activities that are going on thanks to many of you who have been generous with your financial support or technical expertise, including South-South exchange of information. This adds up to a wealth of information that will help countries monitor the land use and manage their own forests better, protect and improve the livelihoods of the people who depend on forests, and in turn help us generate worldwide figures to support global agreements, action plans in areas like climate change, biodiversity conservation, combating desertification, just to name a few. Well, this is bring us back to the question, why? That is, forests cover 30% of the global land area. They contain most of the world's terrestrial biodiversity. Forest land and forest ecosystems store more than 600 gigatons of carbon in the soil, and in the biomass, and that's more carbon than in the whole atmosphere. If we are talking about climate change, we cannot release this carbon outside of this territory. Forests provide livelihoods for more than a billion people and are vital for energy supply, soil, and water protection. Not to mention that they supply construction materials, food ingredients for the family meals, and the fuel to cook these meals. Yet, as we saw from presentation of my colleague Ken, the world continues to lose forests. The rate of forest loss is fortunately slowing in many countries, but the fact remains that we are losing too much. We are still losing too much, and once it's lost, it's very difficult to bring it back. As my colleague mentioned earlier, forest loss continues, especially in the tropical areas of the planet, where it takes significant toll on biodiversity and on livelihoods. We notice the tropical forests of the world are decreasing 70 million, have decreased 70 million hectares in the period 1990-2000, and an estimated loss of 60 million hectares in the period 2000-2010. It's slowing, but it's still alarming. We all know that you cannot manage what you cannot measure. So how are we supporting this? FAO has now a toolbox filled with traditional as well as cutting-edge satellite-based tools to help countries better monitor their forests. This toolbox contains the open source softwares that FAO has developed for collecting data, processing the information, mapping and making the information available for those who take decisions about forest and land use planning. And such softwares are available online for anyone who wishes to use them free of charge. The development of this technology is thanks to many of you who have supported us, especially the government of Finland has made a special commitment for open sources of technology and softwares to improve data collection, for which we are very thankful. In the past, forest surveys were made to estimate the amount of timber available. Today, we go far beyond that. We assess land use change and forest activities, and assess the causes of these land use changes. We also continue to do the field measurement that gives us the specific information about trees, not just how many trees, but how healthy they are, what type they are, what are they used for, who owns them, and how these trees relate to agriculture and to food production. We look at how the forest land changes over time. We conduct household surveys, interview with forest users, local communities to find out from them how the forests have changed and why they change. The FAO Committee on Forests, in the last session in 2012, requested FAO to produce a set of voluntary guidelines on national forest monitoring, taking into account the requirements of REDD+ reporting and in line with the United Nations Forest Instruments. This is an engagement we embraced wholeheartedly. We held meetings at the regional level to get input from the countries, and we will present a preliminary draft of these voluntary guidelines on national forest monitoring during the upcoming session of COFO that will be held in June here in Rome. When approved, these guidelines will be one important element to support national governments in the development of appropriate policies in this area, of course, and will help us focus on a more strategic way the work being developed by FAO and its partners. Of course, we first work with the countries to help evaluate the information they already have. We assess the needs to strengthen the local capacity to use all of these tools and to make informed decisions for moving ahead. The success is not only on how these countries help themselves, but also how they help each other through South-South cooperation. One of these slides shows where we have recently trained people who have then gone on training in other countries. And it's quite satisfying to see how this becomes a continuing. In fact, at this very moment, we are working on a new initiative that will link the largest tropical forest area of the world, the Amazon, with the second largest, the Congo Basin, as Mr. Director General referred in his speech. And Brazilian experts and technologies are shared their experience and knowledge on forest monitoring with 10 countries in the Congo Basin. We are very enthusiastic and excited with this new initiative that is emerging. As we said, FAO and its partner institutions and countries are currently support 48 countries in 5 continents. And we also work to make sure that all countries employ monitoring systems that are compatible at regional and global levels, so the data they can gather can be used across borders and help meet their reporting obligations to international agreements such as the CBD, the UNFCCC, the UNFF, and others. FAO's overarching goal is to give these countries capacity for continuing monitoring their own forests, and the trends in forest land use. For that, FAO works closely with partners to implement projects and programs to develop and improve country capacity monitoring, support countries in the design and establishment of their own monitoring systems. We also developed and disseminate the voluntary guidelines and mobilize inputs from a wide range of experts and resource partners. We advise countries on how to link their national data to design appropriate policies, offer a platform for sharing experiences and knowledge, and at the global level, FAO helps harmonize definitions and reporting requirements. Now, for the past few minutes, we've seen how FAO and partners have helped countries to build capacity to monitor their own forests, and how they are using the tools that are made available to them over the last few years. Just let me bring a few concrete cases. In South Sudan, the country was able to make its first up-to-date land use estimate with entirely free and open source technology developed by FAO. This is very important and reduced a lot the costs of a forest monitoring. In Uganda, with only $20,000 investment, FAO and the Uganda National Forest Authority worked together to update Uganda land cover map, and the National Forest Assessment Team learn how to use the FAO new mapping technology. In Kyrgyz Republic, a 5-year capacity building project provided tools, equipments, and conduct a very successful forest management assessment and established a national forest inventory. Let's take an example at the global level. The results of the FRA, the Global Forest Resource Assessment, are used to assess the carbon emissions from deforestation and the role forest plays in climate change mitigation at the global level. Ladies and gentlemen, the FRA results have assisted in raising billions of dollars to address Red Plus initiatives to reduce deforestation and degradation in developing countries while improving the conservation, sustainable management, and enhancement of forest carbon stocks. Based on these success stories, we can see how we have generated value from the money and time invested in these efforts. Our work on forest monitoring over the last 60 years has evolved and created a solid cornerstone on which to base our future work. The challenges are bigger now when the world recognizes the importance to address forestry, agriculture, and the land use in a holistic way for integrated planning and action. FAO and its partners have created a substantial momentum thanks to new technology, which is cheaper, more efficient, freely accessible, and easy to use. We hope you continue supporting our efforts in the work on forest monitoring to help reverse deforestation, providing our share of information for the world to address some of the challenges towards sustainable development for all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Mansur. Clearly, there's been a lot of investment, both financial and human, to drive those results you mentioned over the last 60 years. Very interesting. And there's obviously a lot of positive changes and exchanges of skills that are really showing clear results on the ground. And we're fortunate enough to hear a little bit more about experiences on the ground from our resource partners today. And we'd like to take a few minutes to discuss with our resource partners their perspective on this issue. I'd first like to welcome the director of the Brazilian Development Bank, Mr. Guillaume Lacerda, who will say a few words about sustainable development in the Amazon. Mr. Lacerda, if you please, thanks.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Firstly, I would like to thank FAO, in special Dr. Graziano, Director General of FAO, and your team for inviting the BNDES to to this event. My compliments to Dr. Andreas and Dr. Henrik from Norway, our main partners in the Amazon Fund. I am a director of BNDES, Brazilian Development Bank, and am responsible for the social infrastructure, environment, and agriculture division. In BNDES, we have other programs for restoration of Brazilian biomes, like Atlantic Forest Program. But today, I will only talk about Amazon Fund. As Dr. Graziano and Dr. Mansur said before, I and my team are here to are preparing a project to tropical forest in Africa. This year, the fund completes 5 years, a pioneer experience that is achieving concrete results. The donated results provide support to non-reimbursable projects of which 20% can be used in other Brazilian biomes and tropical forests in other countries. The disbursements are aligned with the project completion, normally between 3 and 5 years, like you can see in this slide. And you can see in the map the dimension of the Amazon biome in comparison with the countries of the Europe. Fundraising. The Amazon funding raised until now donations of 786 million, the majority from Norway. The fund received donations from Germany and Petrobras, too. We have a partnership with GIZ, the Technical Assistance Agency from Germany. For each donation, the bank issues a diploma that identifies the donor, the amount of the portion of their contribution to efforts aimed at reducing carbon gas emissions. Here we can say about the governance of the, you can see about the governance of the fund. As you can see, there are two committees. The technical committee that define how much can be raised, and the guidance committee that define how and for what the projects. The BNDES manages the donated resource and analyzes the progress of the project receiving resource as support. This slide shows the territorial panorama of the projects. As you can see, they are spread all over the Amazon biome. Last year, we signed the first international project with OTCA. OTCA is the entity to 8 countries in the South America. You have that has a biome Amazon. To transfer the monitoring technologies for all countries covered by Amazon forest. Now, we are preparing a new project to the Congo Basin with the participation with the leadership of the FAO because of we think is very important for us, very important to transfer the technology to help another countries. Here you can see the evolution of the portfolio during 5 years. At the circle, we show the distribution of all supported projects by legal nature. Approximately 35% of the projects are with NGOs and 30% with subnational governments. In this complex graphic of a lot of circles shows the variety of the projects in the different phases. You have in projects under consultation, projects under analysis, and projects supported. And at now, we include three projects already concluded. These projects are related to sustainable production, institutional development, land use planning, scientific and technological development, and the support is about approximately $340 million. These numbers inform you about the total targets of the all projects. Indicators and targets are defined aiming to monitor the projects. Periodically, the achievement of goals is verified, including on-site inspections. Transparency and results reporting are key elements for the Amazon Fund. The website and its annual reports are the main instruments to communicate results. We also publish monthly bulletins and portfolio updates. In summary, this point for us is very, very, very important. The transparency and communication to inform all the world as you using the funds that you receive of the donors. Finally, our last comment about the results of the Brazilian program of protection of the forests. Like you said before, the Amazon Fund is not the unique program. It is exclusively one program. You have a political action to reduce the emission carbon. And the Amazon Fund is a very important, it's a very important initiative to support Brazil efforts aimed at combat deforestation in the Amazon. And this slide shows you like the reduction was in the last years. And this reduction is very important to define the amount of the donation to fundraising. And you can see the last few years, Brazil has obtained impressive results from it. That's all. Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to participate of this event. And if necessary, some information, it's a pleasure to inform to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lacerda. Well, thank you. It's a pleasure to have you here with us. And thank you again for your cooperation, particularly on the Congo Basin project. I would like to now welcome other resource partners to make some remarks and share their experience. I believe we have the permanent representative of the European Union, Ambassador Agemon Pistre, to offer his remarks. Is that correct? Or Ms., excuse me.
Well, Mr. Director General, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, the EU, as an active member of the FAO and a major supporter of FAO programs, is delighted to join this celebration of the International Day of Forest here at FAO headquarters today. This is important to raise awareness at all levels in order to strengthen the sustainable management, conservation, and sustainable development of all types of forests and trees outside forests for the benefit of current and future generations. We welcome the decision to focus this event on the issue of forest monitoring and would like to acknowledge the central role that the FAO plays on this issue, both through its direct support to building national capacities for forest monitoring and through the publication of fundamental knowledge products such as the State of World Forests and Global Forest Resources Assessment, a unique source of data for global forestry issues. We would also like to acknowledge the important work undertaken by the FAO with other organizations, such as the International Tropical Timber Organization, the UNICE, relevant regional organizations, and processes and members of the Montreal Process, on streamlining data gathering and reporting, and on refinement of the collaborative forest resource questionnaire. As recognized in several decisions of the Committee on Forestry, robust and comprehensive information systems and a strengthened knowledge base are indispensable for better forest policies and good governance, as well as to effectively monitor efforts towards implementation of sustainable forest management at the national, regional, and global level. Therefore, we believe that building capacity of FAO members in the areas of forest monitoring and coordination of global efforts in this respect remain a core function of the FAO. It deserves being further expanded and strengthened in line with relevant decisions of FAO's governing bodies, reinforcing FAO links with its member countries to get access to more accurate and reliable information on forest resources remains crucial. The EU has been pleased to support FAO work in this area through a variety of programs and initiatives. As mentioned by Kenny MacDicken, we are very supportive of the FAO for the Global Forest Resources Assessments, FRA, through a €3.7 million project, including a remote sensing survey component. And this is carried out jointly between the FAO and the Joint Research Center, of which we have a representative today I'd like to welcome. We are also proud of our collaboration in the field of forest law enforcement, governance, and trade, which is called FLECT, through the ongoing FLECT program. This €10 million program contributes to building the capacity of national stakeholders. It was illustrated before. And the Commission is now exploring with FAO possibility for strengthening and expanding the FLECT program. So the EU looks forward to a continued cooperation with the FAO in this important area of work, including with regard to the 2015 FAO Global Forest Resources Assessment. In this respect, we look forward to the results of the ongoing evaluation of the FRA program that will contribute to frame the actions of the future program. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Argimont-Piste, for your remarks and ongoing cooperation. Thank you. I'd now like to invite Ms. Sarivara Haikkanen to make a few remarks from Finland. Yes, thank you.
Dear Mr. Director General, dear ladies and gentlemen, I would like to first of all thank FAO for organizing this celebration for the International Day on Forests. Finland appreciates the theme very much, forest monitoring and information. Without the correct, timely and transparent information, sustainable forest management cannot be achieved. We used to say in Finland that we live from forests. Forests are indeed the most important natural resource, covering two-thirds of the surface of Finland. 100 years ago, Finland was a poor agricultural country, and our GDP was only the half of what the leading countries, the Great Britain and US, had that time. We got out of poverty through the natural resources sector, especially forestry. We know that sustainable management of forests is key to sustained incomes. I represent the Ministry for Foreign Affairs of Finland and especially the Department for Development Cooperation. We manage the development cooperation funds. We in our policies emphasize sustainable, transparent, and democratic governance and management of natural resources that enhances social stability and reduces hunger and poverty. Particular emphasis needs to be put on protecting the rights and livelihoods of poor people who depend on these basic resources. With the voluntary funding directed to the FAO, we want to promote sustainable forest management, climate sustainability, and food security, also in humanitarian crises and early recovery. We have for years supported FAO's work in the field of forests. The funding for the ongoing forest-related programs and the projects is 32.8 million euros in total. The biggest support we have given to the program for sustainable forest management in a changing climate, which totals 15.25 million euros. That program has focused in strengthening the FAO resources and capacity in methodological and tool development at FAO headquarters and in five pilot countries: Ecuador, Peru, Tanzania, Vietnam, and Zambia. Special emphasis has been given to providing tools and methods for multipurpose forest inventories and for Red Plus monitoring and climate change adaptation, supporting the collection of quality forest resources data on which to base policy decisions in forestry and establishing closer links between NFMAs and NFPs. We are very happy to see that as one of the results, the open forest tools are widely used by FAO and its cooperation partners, not to mention other users around the world. In addition to this program, we have funded bilateral forestry programs in Tanzania, Zambia, Nepal, and Kosovo, and we are currently funding the Forest and Farm Facility. And we will also support the World Forestry Congress organized by FAO. From donors and cooperation partners' perspective, I would like to bring some notations. We highly value FAO's willingness to make organizational changes and improve the effectiveness and results-oriented activities. For the programs funded by us, it is important to have effective country-level activities with the needed level of decentralization and strengthened coordination between the headquarters and country offices. What comes to the results achieved on the country level, it is of utmost importance to take the results into the policy level. We are glad to see that the inter-organizational cooperation and FAO's cooperation with different development partners has been strengthened, also in line with the One UN approach. In addition, we are with a great interest following the implementation of the recommendations of the strategic evaluation of FAO's role and work in forestry. And if we look into the future, forests offer excellent opportunities for sustainable development and green bio-based economy. We are convinced that through sustainable management of natural resources base and innovation, we will be able to provide new forest-based products and services. Everything that we manufacture today from fossil-based plastics, we might be able to do from renewable biomass. For example, today in UN Geneva, there will be a similar kind of celebration where forest-based fashion will be introduced. Also, a car made out of bio-based components will be shown. Lastly, I believe that we need to ensure that forests are adequately addressed in the ongoing post-2015 considerations. both in the sustainable development goals as well as international financing. Thank you very much, and I wish us all a good day on forests. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. And if you remember Mr. Mansour's presentation, a lot of the video footage that you saw was actually made possible because of the support of Finland. So those are some of the projects going on from Finland in Vietnam and in Tanzania. A lot of those results right there that you saw on the screen before you. Thank you again. Next, I would like to invite from Germany, Mr. Hausmann. Thank you.
Director General, ladies and gentlemen, first of all, many thanks for organizing this International Day of Forest. As a forester, I really believe that it's more than important to celebrate this day, but it also underlines that FAO is the leading international organization also in the field of forestry, and I think it's very important to also remind this. The item of today's celebration is monitoring. And that brings me back to the start of my professional career, end of the 80s in Germany. The term forest dieback, Waldsterben, was at those days on the headlines in all the newspapers. And if you know the relationship not only of the Finnish people, but also the German people to their forest, there was quite some even panic and some questions to the policymakers to react on this new phenomenon. And it's of course very difficult for policymakers to react if they have no sound basis on the extent of the damage, on the severeness, on the area affected. And therefore it was so important to set up within a very short time a forest health monitoring, not only in Germany but later on all over Europe. And today it's also expanded to some other area of the world, in order to know more about forest ecosystem and the input of the acid deposition and the reaction of the system, in order to provide policymakers with sound basis for their reactions. And what I learned is that, and this was mentioned already before, that there are a number of difficulties with the data. Data quality is a big issue. You need, of course, to create reliable data, not only between the countries in order to have these nice statistics and nice maps, but also within the time series. Of course, you have to look at the cost effectiveness. Remote sensing is a very important tool, but also quite cost intensive. Therefore, as you have mentioned, the link with the terrestrial data is very important. And so there are a number of very important issues which are not so easy if you look at the end of the nice graphs and maps. I would like to come back to the speech of the General Director, because you mentioned that we have to manage our forests in a sustainable way. And it's of course very, very timely, because 300 years ago, Mr. Karlowitz defined the term sustainability. It's of course one of the issues which I think is used not only in the forestry world, but worldwide very often, sustainability. But it's not so easy to define and to prove that the management of our forest is done in a sustainable way. And of course, since the last 300 years, the term sustainability has been developed from the timber supply to a more larger definition. And one of the issues which could help to define sustainable forest management are criteria and indicators on sustainable forest management. This concept of criteria indicator was already agreed in the European region within the MCPFE process, that's the Ministerial Conference on the Protection of Forests in Europe, in 1994. Later on, picked up also at the UN level in New York. And of course, there are a number of other regions like the Montreal process discussing a criteria indicator, defining them. And later on, also from other areas, from the climate change community, the CBD, the Convention on Biological Diversity, on the Rio process, other criteria and indicator approaches came up. And this is an issue which I think is very important to keep stock on the various initiatives going on, and if possible, to agree on a global set of criteria and indicators. And the Europeans, they have in the meantime got a very important task from the European Forest Institute, and kind of an evaluation of the 94 criteria. And we are very happy that FAO picked up this issue on the criteria and indicator for sustainable forest management in a project, a 2 years project, which will bring together the experts from the various regions to discuss their approaches on criterion indicator and to try to come to a common set at technical level, which might later on be picked up by the global initiatives. This is one of the points I would like to add from the German perspective, that we believe the criterion indicator for sustainable forest management is very important beside the other issues mentioned. And this is one of the issues Germany would like to support. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hausmann. Yes, criterion indicators, we cannot forget about them. So thank you for reminding us about them today. Norway, Mr. Veteras, I believe. Yes, great, thank you.
Good morning, and a huge thank you to FAO, the Director General, FAO staff, distinguished colleagues. Director Lasarda, thank you for your presentation of the Amazon Fund. I'm very happy to be here for the celebration of the International Forest Day. Before I venture into talking about the importance of forest monitoring, I would like to take one step back to look at the bigger picture. As we just saw presented, the latest statistics indicate that forests are still disappearing at an alarming rate, and we have very good documentation of the negative effect of that loss in terms of the loss of livelihoods, the loss of potential sources of income, economic growth, the loss of biodiversity, and of course the release of carbon to the atmosphere. But still, the fact is that the loss continues. And clearly this situation has to change, and therefore I am particularly happy to be celebrating this Forest Day here in FAO. The day, as you know, is being celebrated many places around the world, but I think it is particularly good to celebrate it here because FAO is the agency with the mandate to handle both the forest but also the biggest driver of deforestation, which is the agricultural sector. So the combination of these mandates gives FAO a particular responsibility, but also particular possibilities in being part of the solution. So what is the solution? I think very broadly speaking, this is a very broad simplification, but there are two key aspects of work if we are going to change this trend. First, forests have to become more worth dead than alive. Sorry, alive than dead, which in many cases the opposite is the situation now. So we have to put in place incentives that changes the situation and makes forests more valuable as living resources than is currently often the situation, at least in the short term in many countries. The other part of the solution is, of course, that agricultural production that has to increase to feed the growing population cannot increase at the cost of forests. So we have to increase the production without causing more forest conversion, which is a huge challenge, but it is a challenge that the FAO is particularly well placed to help us tackle. But let me go back to the first part, the enhancing the value of the forest part, and I think there are many avenues in along that path. But REDD+, that has been mentioned many times here, is definitely one very important element of that path. And I think since the last celebration of Forest Day, we have seen one very important groundbreaking decision, and that is the Warsaw climate change negotiations that concluded with a framework to do REDD+. And that is a groundbreaker in terms of future forest conservation and management. As many of you know, Norway has made REDD+ a priority of our international climate change mitigation support. And over the last 6 years, we have invested significantly in this, working closely with a big number of partner countries, but also very closely with the UN in the UN REDD program, where FAO is one of the three key agencies. We very strongly appreciate that support that the FAO is providing this work globally. FAO plays an important role, but I do want to also express my appreciation of the enormous efforts that a big number of developing countries are putting into preparing and implementing REDD+ policies. But then what does REDD+ then require from FAO in terms of forest monitoring support? First of all, FAO can provide assistance in developing monitoring systems that make countries able to report to the Convention on Climate Change on reducing emission from forest degradation and deforestation. This is work that FAO has been providing under the UN REDD program for the last 5 years, and with the Warsaw decision, I am certain that the demand for that support is going to grow exponentially in the years to come. But of course, monitoring and reporting is not only useful to report on figures, it is also an equally and more important a tool that you use when designing and implementing measures to reduce deforestation. These systems can help countries identify where deforestation hotspots are. They can identify which are the key drivers at a particular location that causes deforestation. It can identify where you have the particularly valuable forests in terms of importance for ecosystem services, biodiversity conservation, income generation, energy supply, etc., so that you can combine objectives of carbon conservation with other benefits. But let me, and these are fields where FAO is providing support, will continue to provide support. But I would like to then turn to the second part of the solution, the importance of ensuring that food production is increased without further conversion of forest. Because it really doesn't matter how good the forest monitoring systems are if the trend continues and they only serve to better document a downward slowing trend. So therefore, I will end here by strongly underlining the importance of FAO ensuring that there are strong links between the work you do to ensure food security, which is an absolute necessary deal and challenge to solve, but we do without doing it in ways that cause further deforestation. And from Norway's side, we strongly look forward to our continued cooperation on this field. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Veteras. I'd now like to welcome the Russian Federation. I believe we have a representative from the Russian Federation here to make a statement. Is that correct? No? Moving on. Okay. Thank you for being here, anyway. then I would like to invite Sweden, Ambassador Norden van Gansberg, who will make a few remarks. Thank you.
Uh, not so tall as some of my colleagues are. Dear Director General, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, it is indeed an honor for me to participate in today's second celebration of the International Day of Forests, focusing on monitoring as the representative of Sweden, a country where forests cover half the country. I know it sounds paltry with the Finnish colleagues saying two-thirds, but still half the country. But farmland only constitutes 8% of land use. And from early on, already at the beginning of the 19th century, Sweden had tried to keep track of the treasure that is our forest. We had several very committed people at the beginning of the 1800s who tried to chart the forest. And as similar to Finland again, in no small measure, the forest lifted us out of poverty and starvation. In 1850, Sweden was an extremely poor rural country. Then something happened. We started to be able to use our forests, and also, of course, we have rivers that are very conveniently located for transporting the forest out to the coast. New cities were actually being built on those coasts to accommodate the forestry industry. I come from a city with the exotic name in English of Eagle Shield Bay, where there is a big company called Modo, which you might have heard about, a pulp and paper company. And rural development was possible because of this expansion. And as the industry grew, as we've heard here, concerns arose concerning the sustainability. And already, I must say, I'm quite impressed with my forebears. Already in 1905, there was a law passed that mandated reforestation. If you took something out of the forest, you had to put it back. And today, over 100 years after this first law, 11% of Swedish exports come from the forest, which I think is quite interesting. And if I might go off on a personal note, we heard the term social values. I think all children, still to this day in Sweden, when you search for recreation, you go to the forests. You can pick berries, you pick mushrooms, you go running, you have sports activities, you go skiing in the winter time. So it is a huge part of our psyche as well. So forests are important to us. It is no coincidence that our national vision is called the Forest Kingdom, because this is how we see the forest. And this vision has four branches. The forest will deliver more raw material, as the Norwegian colleague mentioned, but biodiversity will be preserved and forests will be used sustainably. Social values will be protected and Sweden's forest sector will be gender equal. We've actually a large number of women who own tracts of land. So we have also another brochure which emphasizes the fact that to be competitive, you need to use your entire resources, i.e. both men and women. And in order to fulfill our vision and for others to fulfill their forest visions, it is, as we have heard time and time again today, to have reliable data on forest assets so as to make the right decisions, formulate optimal policies, and have a base for a wise forest management. We thus wholeheartedly support the forest inventory programs from the strategic evaluation of FAO's role and work in forestry. As I'm sure you've seen the final report from June 2012, it is clear that FAO's Global Forest Resource Assessment Program is highly relevant for various users and various levels. FRA is a worldwide reference on the state of the world's forests. Sweden welcomes FAO's new landscape approach, with the understanding, as pointed out by my Norwegian colleague, that agriculture and forestry are indeed interconnected. If forests are harvested, this might lead to, for instance, water scarcity for agriculture. So good cross-sectoral cooperation is vital, but at all levels, not just inside the governments, but as we also pointed out, good regional and international cooperation. And through our development agency, CEDA, we support the new forest farm facility. Finally, I would like just to say, speaking about CEDA, I would like to be clear that the negotiations for our new extra budgetary support are still far from finished, but it is very likely that Sweden will renew its commitment to FAO's activities in general, and I will come back on that issue. Thank you very much.
Well, we've heard quite a lot already. We've got the Congo Basin Initiative, the Forest Law Enforcement Governance and Trade Initiative, Criterion Indicators, Red Plus, the Forest Resources Assessment, the Forest and Farm Facility. There is a lot going on. There's a lot to do, too. I wonder if there are other resource partners or other government delegates here who would like to discuss their perspectives and provide us with some more insights on some of these topics or anything else they'd wish to bring up at the present time. The U.S.?
Good morning. My name is Laura Schweitzer-Mines, and I am part of the U.S. Department of Agriculture based in our U.S. mission here in Rome. And it is a great pleasure to be here. Thank you to FAO, to the DG, and all of the hardworking staff here for this excellent celebration of the International Day of Forests. With rapid innovations in remote sensing and information technology, the way the world monitors forests and forest change is developing at an unprecedented pace. The Forest Resources Assessment Program, UNFAO, maintains the main global source for biophysical and economic data on the world's forests, involving intensive work and reporting. The U.S. congratulates FAO, their efforts towards streamlining forest data gathering and reporting with other collaborative partnership on forests members, such as ITTO, UNECE, and members of the Montreal process, through the refinement of the Collaborative Forest Resource Questionnaire. Internationally, the U.S. values FRA's commitment to work with all member countries to standardize reporting of key forest metrics that promote maintaining forests for future generations. The sharing of standards for measurement and reporting throughout the world helps each country identify opportunities to improve the management and ultimately the sustainability of our forests. The United States, through its bilateral programs, collaborates directly with regional FAO staff in assisting partner countries to develop solid inventory systems and data collection methods. Silva Carbon is a U.S. interagency program that assists developing countries in monitoring and managing forest and terrestrial carbon. The Silva Carbon Program has been working with FAO to jointly deliver carbon management workshops in Southeast Asia and in South America. Silva Carbon and FAO are both members of the Global Forest Observation Initiative. Under this initiative, Silva Carbon and the U.S. government and FAO work together to deliver training and guidance on forest carbon mapping and monitoring. In May of this year, the first GFOI workshop for Africa will take place in Douala, Cameroon, and will include presentations on forest monitoring by the U.S. government, the FAO FRA, and other partners. Through these partnerships, U.S. scientists also learn valuable lessons which we incorporate into our own inventory process back home. Domestically, the U.S. will begin monitoring tree cover in urban areas nationwide to complement our routine forest inventories outside of urban areas. We will also begin an aggressive monitoring program to track land cover and land use trends, as well as improve biomass and carbon monitoring. We will continue to work with Canada and Mexico on compatible forest monitoring strategies in the North American region. We recognize that inventory and monitoring work is a continuous, painstaking process of collecting data, improving accuracy and consistency of information, creating common understanding of definitions, and adapting to the changing technologies and information needs of users. We applaud the hard work of FAO, particularly its commitment to collaborate with the CPF, the Collaborative Partnership on Forests, and other stakeholders to gain efficiencies through technology advances, and all the national correspondents who participate in providing the valuable information that feeds into the Forest Resources Assessment. Thank you very much for letting me speak and for having us here today.
Thank you, Ms. Means, for being with us today and telling us a lot about the Silva Carbon Project and the value of the FRA as well. Russian Federation. Okay, now I believe the Russian Federation would like to make a statement, please. Thank you.
My name is Boris Roshin, Director of International Department Activity of Russian Federal Forestry Agency. Dear Mr. Chairman, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues. First of all, I would like to express the gratitude to the FAO and its forestry department on behalf of Mr. Vladimir Lebedev, head of the Russian Federal Forestry Agency, for the invitation to celebrate the International Day on Forests at the respectable international organization that does its best for sustainable development of forest ecosystems. Unfortunately, he is not able to participate personally at the event due to the tight schedule of earlier planned appointments. That's why Mr. Lebedev has requested me to express his kindest regard and best wishes to all participants of today's event. At the global level, Russia cooperates efficiently with many international organizations, take part in activity of various mechanism and negotiation process. The internal spirit and principle of which are based on a real scientific approach, creativity, and sincere striving to reach a sustainable development of the forest ecological systems. Russia is glad to see the beneficial cooperation with FAO in progress. Thus, we are here today. Russia felt excited about the idea of International Day of Forests to be celebrated today. We believe the initiative will not be limited just by one day. On behalf of the Russian Federal Forestry Agency, allow me to voice consideration that, in the opinion of the Russian side, play a significant role in improving the adequacy of forest inventory and, as a consequence, the effectiveness of developing global and regional strategies for sustainable development of forestry and forest industry. First of all, we would like to note the importance of boreal forest. In Russia, which has a 1/5 of the earth forest cover, boreal forests are prevalent ones. At the same time, up to the present time, there are blind spots in the research field, which do not allow sufficient accuracy to determine their contribution into the solution of the current global problems, such as climate change, biodiversity, land degradation, water supply, etc. In this regard, the Russian Federation proposes to consider the matter of development an international plan of action for the boreal forests under the auspices of the organization at the upcoming 22nd regular session of the FAO Committee on Forests in June 2014. We hope that this proposal will find understanding and support not only by the boreal zone countries, but also by all member states of FAO, who realize the productivity of global cooperation in the field of forestry. Necessary condition for achieving progress in the assessment of monitoring on forest from the standpoint of the Federal Forestry Agency is the presence of a single universal terminology of in forestry for all states. It will unify the methods of analysis of information received and, what is the most important, will provide professionals with the opportunity to speak the same language, almost certainly realizing goals and objectives. FAO believe may be the lead in establishing the International Glossary of Forestry Terminology, as the organization possessing comprehensive information and database, as well as the potential of highly qualified specialists on forests, both its own and borrowed from the member states. And last but not least, the Russian proposal concerns the need for wide dissemination by FAO, permanently improved methodology on forest remote sensing at the continuous basis. It will be particularly reasonable for the implementation of inventory in countries having, like Russia, vast or inaccessible forest areas. In this context, I would like to inform that the Federal Forestry Agency of Russia has elaborated project proposals for the modernization of the existing national system for collecting, processing, and interpretation of remote sensing data on forests, for development of new methodology, and as well as on the preparation of relevant research professionals. We hope that the Forest Department of FAO will assist the Russian Federation, Federation in the implementation of planned projects. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your intervention. And FAO does have quite a historical basis on which to undertake some of these discussions. So we will look forward to working with you in the run-up to COFO. Are there any other statements from the floor at this time? Anyone else who would like to say a few words? The floor is open. Yes, up here please with the mic. Oh.
Yes. Thank you. I didn't prepare really anything, but I just wrote a few things. My name is Mark Herrmann. I'm from the Belgian Embassy, and we support FAO with its work. Now, I don't know much about forests, but I saw a lot of forests. I'm a field person, and I worked for many years, in Zambia, in Gabon, in Cameroon, in Senegal, and Morocco. And I've seen the devastation and the land erosion and huge forest fires, bushfires, spreading over tens of kilometers and with flames up to 30 meters high. And I saw forest cuts in Cameroon, my Asian companies, left bare to die. And I went in the field and I saw huge trees being cut down, taking when they fell all the trees around them. But I also saw farmers tending to their trees with love and children playing in the trees. Now, when FAO came to us a few years ago, 2 years ago, they didn't have too much to convince the permanent representation of Belgium. And of course, we said yes. And now our forests are aid to FAO, and I believe very much in the work they are doing, is part of the 9.2 million voluntary contribution of Belgium over 3 years. And let me say also that this voluntary contribution is non-earmarked, which means that FAO basically decides, I mean, what they're going to do with the money. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And thank you very much for sharing your personal experience and seeing with your own eyes about how forests impact people's lives. Thanks for sharing that and for the ongoing contributions. Thank you. I understood that there was a representative from Poland. Is that correct? Is there someone? No? Oh, okay. Thank you. Anyone else? Okay. If that's the case, then I would like to turn the floor over to our Assistant Director General for FAO Forestry, Eduardo Rojas-Briales, who will make a few closing remarks and also launch a new product from FAO Forestry, the Forestry Communication Toolkit. Eduardo.
Thank you, Lauren, Director General, Deputy Director General, permanent representatives, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen. Bonjour, buenos dias, good morning, and welcome to everybody, and congratulations for celebrating the second International Day of Forests. And allow me to start thanking those present that have come, some of you from very far, from Brazil, from Russia, and from other countries. Of course, to thank the resource partners that are here, and those who are not here, who have allowed us to conduct this impressive work, and for sure, the staff that has conducted that work here in headquarters, but very especially in the field. You have heard about 1,000 people which are working not always in easy conditions in the field. So it was quite clear why we need forest monitoring, and the basic driver for that is to take the right decision. With this data, we can do lots of things, but without those data, we are just in the fog. For example, there are countries where deforestation is increasing. On the contrary, they have been able to turn it, and if imagine you are a doctor and you think that your patient has high blood pressure, and in fact he or she has low blood pressure, you may provide with the wrong diagnosis, the wrong treatment, and you may even kill or create a health critical health issue because you were not aware on which health situation the patient was. So this is at the end the work that based the diagnosis. It's also very important that we frame this work. It's not a self objective. So we need an important policy element. Governance is an important element, a rising issue in this house and in general, that defines what for this important investment in monitoring is needed for, and when we have the result, to interpret the corresponding policy decision. During the process is basically a field work, a very technical, a very statistical work, where the policy work in certain way goes back, but it has to come again to interpret it. And this is very important in a context. Ken commented this tension between the remote sensing work that is, of course, much more easy, much more less costly per hectare, and the need to work on the ground. But we have to add another component, and I will link it to the next SOFO, the State of World Forest, which would be the basic element for the next Committee on Forestry in June, which is the need to have much more information on the socioeconomic elements. We speak about the billion people that rely on forests. We speak how many social benefits come for the rural poor that live in the faraway areas, be in boreal zone, be in tropical zones. At the end, they are disadvantaged in each of the development stadiums. And at the end, we are speculating most of these figures because there's normally forest inventories are extraordinarily silent on these socioeconomic contributions. We perceive them, as the representative of Belgium said, due to your fieldwork, but we don't have the data evidence that shows how important these contributions are for the livelihood. So in that sense, it's very important there is a policy input that says what data we need and that the correspondent work is also not done on the forest from the air or from the ground, but as well with the people around to have this strong data. I think this is a work that we'll have ahead in the next years.
And how this is framed as well with the new strategic frame of FAO, the biggest strategic objective is SO2, as you know, and in that, the fourth organizational outcome is exactly around this, and forestry, due to the challenges of these resources and the long tradition that was very interesting explained by Ken and by Mansur, is at the end in a leading position in this area, because of course our work has been very advanced and very broad in this area, and we want of course to share it with the other disciplines in the house. Like in other areas, we have the opposite situation. In, for example, legally binding agreements, fisheries colleagues are much more advanced, the forestry. So there's a lot of learning that we can do in the new strategic framework. I would like also to highlight the importance of South-South cooperation as a complementary and an upscaling possibility, and we look very much forward to the program in Congo, but this is just a first step for other working both with Benetes and with other South-South cooperation partners. There is a need of both of global data that we can provide by remote sensing, but as well of country support data. And at the end, it feedbacks because our forest resource assessments would be as strong and as reliable as possible, the better the data in the countries are. And I would recall these 48 countries that we are supporting, which is important, and the fact that in this case, with Finnish support, we're working with open technologies, with modern IT processes that allow that we have interchangeable capacities and countries can work it. And I would insist that FAO doesn't want to create a dependency. We want to work in the edge of knowledge, share with countries, but the replication and the spreading around can be done by the countries themselves, by regional organizations, or by other development partners. We have not the capacity to work in all the countries in this area, but we want is that the work progresses and spreads. And in that sense, that's why we're using these open sources and many others. So it's also important to highlight, and we appreciate very much the several mentioning to our work in a collaborative engagement. Now we have 6 or 7 partners in the collaborative forest resource questionnaires and in the frame of the CPF. And for sure, in order to upscale the work and to avoid that we are contradicting definitions and processes. And we take for sure a very important proposal from Russia regarding the terminology. It's important also that globally, this data can move us to actions. We have seen cases that still frustrate us regarding deforestation, but we are seeing as well very interesting, encouraging examples, like the Brazil process, which is getting very, very low deforestation, and we hope that the next remote sensing survey date in 2015 will show already important decrease in South America. And we have seen China contributing basically to this data from Asia that we have seen in size. There are smaller countries that are contributing, in India is a medium one, Vietnam, Philippines, and so on. But of course, the bulk in Asia is China. And it is very important to see this as a chance. There have been many countries been able to turn deforestation. And in that sense, this data may allow to create a momentum to upscale the work around red and forest landscape restoration, because there is a chance. If many countries have turned the tide from the developed world, practically all, case of Korea is very paradigmatic, Israel, there is the case of Uruguay, of Chile, of Costa Rica. There are many countries that have been able, also in the African continents, especially the North African countries have done impressive work, Gambia with the community-based management, Bhutan. There are many countries of the world that have been able to turn deforestation. If we can show it by data, and can share the key elements of governance that have driven the process and socioeconomic changes, we will be able then to help the other countries who lag behind. So that is an important issue. So this is a quite a crucial issue. I would like just to make a few comments regarding the Sustainable Development Goal processes. It is not to us to say how they should be packaged, but eventually to invite that more clearer consideration of forests could be get into sustainable development goal structure. For the moment, forests are relatively invisible. Even mountains, which are also our responsibility, are even more invisible. And it seems like we are getting again the three pillars, the economic, the social, and the environmental, very cornered in each of the potential SDGs. And where forest is ending with biodiversity and ecosystem without mentioning it, there's the risk that it is very just environmental driven. And this socioeconomic contribution of forest might be very difficult to highlight if that would consolidate. And in discussion with the key people in UNEP, we share this frustration that we are coming again to splitting instead of integrating the three pillars of sustainable development. That was exactly what Rio Plus 20 wanted to achieve, the full integration of the third. And forest may be exactly ideally placed to highlight how the three pillars can be integrated. So I invite you that we all try to get forest in a better setting. However it's packed, there are lots of possibilities, but not just cornered on one of the potential, but much more clear. Finally, just to close, reflecting why we need this International Day of Forest. Communications is very important for us as UN, as public organization, to account what we are doing and why we are using scarce public resources, but surely also for you and all the partners in the forest area. Forest, frequently, due to urbanization, is hardly understood by urban people, and in that sense, communication, proactive communication, is crucial. And that's why chances like the International Year of Forest 2011 and this time the International Day of Forest are very important. And I want to highlight this, the fact that the General Assembly approved it last in 2012 and last year was first implemented was a collective work that this House achieved, the countries and FAO. It was a proposal of COFO in 2010 that went then to the conference 2011, got a very strong backstop of the conference, and then Algeria as chair of the G77 in New York in 2012 was very constant to get it passed with support of practically all the countries. And now we are really seeing that many of our regional offices, Bangkok had this morning, our night, a very impressive celebration. Today are celebrations in many of our country and decentralized offices, but also in the countries we're getting a wealth of activities in countries. For example, France has arranged just 150 events around the day today. So really impressive, and FAO and UNFF are the two agencies responsible to conduct in the day. And we are in that sense of the understanding that communication is so important, supporting regional forest communicator networks to create capacities in the regions and to share the capacities. And we look forward also to your support for these networks. And I would just like to end with the presentation of a toolkit that should exactly support our partners, be the countries, the heads of forest services of the countries that are the members of our statutory bodies, Regional Forestry Commission and Committee of Forestry, last week of June meeting here, but as well the wealth of partners in the private sector, as the Director General commented, all right around family forestry, which is related to the International Year of Family Forestry, communities, indigenous people, forest-based industries, academic, for all these partners that they have not to reinvent the wheel, they can use all these elements to celebrate the International Day of Forest, and of course to communicate around the day on forest. So thanks a lot for your attention, and I ask Lauren to present you the video.
Okay. Thank you, Eduardo, and for reminding us of the importance of the SDG process in the run-up to 2015. Can we just cue the video so we can explain to people how the Forestry Communicators Toolkit works? And this is free, easy to use, accessible to all. We hope it's going to help you with some messages on forests on a variety of themes. Play. Okay, so I'll explain it because I don't hear sound. Basically, what's going on here is if you look at the FAO Forestry website, you're going to see a number of there's going to be the Communicators Toolkit coming up. And it's implemented by FAO Forestry as a response to the new media landscape. And it's, of course, in line with our goal to increase communication support to countries and partners. That's how it looks right on our website. The structure and presentation of the various communication resources in the toolkit aims to maximize the use and dissemination by FAO stakeholders around the world. All this information, all the themes you see. So you can click on each of those themes. And for instance, if you're selecting on climate change, the user is presented with a series of messages and videos, different kinds of publications pertaining to climate change. And alternatively, users who are specifically searching for a video can access the professionally produced videos grouped by region. And the same is true for publications as well. The publications are up there, photos, and graphics as well. So you can download this and integrate it into your presentations, educational materials, different types of things that you want to use in order to communicate about forests. And the toolkit also offers a number of interviews with experts on a wide range of topics. So you could use these as you see fit. The resources that are displayed here, they're principally designed to contextualize and illustrate forestry's core information products, including publications, all of the resources in the toolkit. As I said, they're freely available on the FAO Forestry website, and users are invited to adapt and reuse the information according to their needs. So that's a quick summary. We invite you to use it and encourage you to promote forestry, particularly on days like this, the International Day of Forests. So in closing, I just want to thank the Director General, José Graziano da Silva, for being here with us today and listening to a lot of the experiences that everyone has shared, including our resource partners, Ms. Helena, Maria Helena Samedo, who's our Deputy Director General for Natural Resources, and our special guests, ambassadors, and everyone here to celebrate the International Day of Forests. Of course, I'd just like to thank the FAO Forest Assessment Management and Conservation Division for their excellent efforts in putting together this event, as well as other staff in FAO Forestry and our corporate communications team who assisted with the preparations and our webcast. Yes, folks, you've been webcasted today. Of course, I'd like to also thank our interpreters for the excellent support to this event. I'd now like to welcome you all in the area adjacent to this room for some light refreshments and also, of course, to continue our discussions on the themes we've mentioned today. For those of you who are watching this event via webcast, we've hoped that you've enjoyed today's discussions and have drawn some inspiration that will help you take action today on the International Day of Forests. As we've seen in the opening video, forests are part of our lives and we depend on them for many basic needs throughout our lives. Though we face challenges to improve our forests, they are in many ways a common resource, and we are united in a common cause to improve them. Thank you very much, everyone, and I appreciate you being here today. Thanks. Absolutely. Do we have more copies?